As Kelly grew up, when she was two, she had problems with her legs and feet. Her feet were extremely turned in and her legs were bowed. And so she had to wear corrective shoes. And at night, she would kick and fight until she got out of them. But one day, on the way home from work, her dad stopped at a garage sale and he bought this little pair of shoe skates, you know, the ones that come up on the ankles. And one morning I got up to find Kelly on top of the refrigerator, shuffling back and forth on the fridge in these roller skates. She was a little daredevil. She did all kinds of things like this. She started doing tumbles out of bed instead of getting up like normal people do. And so I knew that she had some gymnastics potential. So when she was five, she started in gymnastics. By the time she was seven, she was competing. She was also incredibly smart. So as a seventh grader at C.D. Foulkes Middle School in Round Rock, Kelly had been a competitive gymnast since the time she was seven. She was on the A-team volleyball team, the A-team basketball team. She was scheduled to run track in the spring. She was second academically in a class of 290 seventh graders. She took German. She was in karate. She brought home two first place trophies from Houston in the first karate meet that she went to. I mean, she was a very, very well-rounded young lady. But she was also very modest. She was very sweet and just everybody's friend. She had a smile, I say, bigger than Dallas. And everybody loved Kelly. So their dad and I divorced a couple years before Kelly died. And my youngest daughter, who had a lot of emotional and developmental problems, was always a daddy's girl. So she moved back to New Mexico with dad, where his parents were, and grandparents were helping with her. My oldest daughter had already moved out on her own. So it was just Kelly and me living in our home in Round Rock. The summer between the sixth and seventh grade, which was the summer of July 1989, yeah, it's been almost 30 years ago now, Kelly was going to a cheerleading camp in San Marcos, and so her cheerleading sponsors decided to have a practice half a day for the week leading up to the cheerleading camp. So otherwise, Kelly would have been at home, but I dropped her off on my way to work in Austin, and she would call me at lunchtime and say she was ready to be picked up, and I'd take my lunch break and drive back to Round Rock and pick her up and take her home and go back to work. So on Tuesday of that week, she phoned and said, "Mom, instead of you coming all the way out here to pick me up, can I just go home and spend the night with one of the other cheerleaders and you get me tomorrow?" And I thought, well, yeah, that's great. So after work, I went to Georgetown to look at cars. I was shopping for a new car and was planning on saving my old car until Kelly got old enough to drive. So I didn't go straight home. When I got home from work about maybe 7:30, this was in July in the summertime, so it was still plenty light outside, I pulled my car into the garage, I went through the door, set my purse down on the table, and immediately someone started banging on my front door, just knocking really loud. So I went to the door and I opened it, and it was Terrence, the 12-year-old boy next door. Kelly was still 12 at the time, too. He was one of Kelly's classmates. He was one of my carpool kids, because I drove the athletes to school every morning an hour before the bus ran. And Terrence quickly announced, "Did you know your house was broken into today?" And it scared me half to death. I mean, here it was, just me and my daughter living there. So he proceeded to tell me the story that he had been watching television that morning, and he kept hearing the neighbor's dog on the other side of us. He lived on the right side, and the neighbors on the left side had a dog. And he kept hearing the dog just barking louder and louder, and he finally thought that there was something wrong with Kelly. And so he came over, and when he did, he scared the burglar away. So I thought, what a wonderful young man. So I had him come in while I called the police, and he was very interested in me calling the police to report this. So when the police came out, they just kind of passed it off as though it was probably teenagers looking for drugs or drug money. And it was Kelly's bedroom window that Terrence showed me that had been broken out. So when the police left, I had Terrence help me board some plywood over the bedroom window, the broken window, because it was going to be the next day before the glass company could come out and fix it. And I remember telling some of my friends how Terrence had probably saved me from truly being robbed. All of my, you know, TV, VCR, stereo, all of this was still in the living room. What was taken was mainly small things from Kelly's room, her camera, her radio, her watch, you know, little things like that of Kelly's. And I thought it was kind of odd, but you know, didn't think too much about it. So that was on Tuesday. On Saturday night of that week, Kelly had one of her girlfriends over to spend the night, and I had to go in to work some overtime the next morning, so I had gone to bed. I think by then the girls may have gone to bed too. So about 1:30 in the morning, hear this big loud knock on my front door. And of course it scared me half to death. Again, the girls met me in the hall. All three of us went to the front porch, or to the front door. I turned on the porch light, looked through the peephole, and I saw that it was Terrence standing on my front porch. So I opened the door and I said, "Terrence Sampson, what are you doing out here in the middle of the night?" And he said, "I went out to get some dishes that we left earlier in the evening. I was doing dishes and I heard your gate creaking in the wind. I think the burglar's back." So here my heart starts beating like crazy again. You know, now I have two teenage girl or adolescent girls that I'm responsible for, and maybe the burglar is back prowling around my house. So I thanked him. I called the police again. They walked the perimeter of the house, didn't find anything. So it took us a long time to regain our comfort and safety in our own home. And I tell the men in my prison program, your home is supposed to be your sanctuary. You know, that is where you can go and feel safe, because that's your home, you know. And so now I'm going to fast forward from July and to December. So on the night of December 1st, a large group of kids, Kelly and Terrence were both in seventh grade by now, and a large group of kids, seventh and eighth graders, got together to go to the Round Rock movie theater to see Chevy Chase's Christmas Vacation. You know, a lot of you have probably seen that funny movie. Every time I see it, I think back to that night of picking Kelly and her friend up and them telling me about this great movie they just saw on the drive home. So once again, I had to go in and work some overtime. I worked at IBM, and I had a very long, very successful career at IBM. But at this point in time, we had some really big projects that were running behind schedule, and so we were having to do a lot of weekend overtime. So when the girls went to bed, I told them I have to get up and go into work tomorrow morning. And Kelly announced to me that her friend's mother was gonna come pick her up about 10 the next morning, and she'd just go home with her, and I could pick Kelly up when I got off work. So the next morning I got up, fixed breakfast for the girls, went into work. At 5 o'clock when I got off, I stopped and picked Kelly up at her friend's. We went to Shortstop Hamburger. I can still remember these details like it was yesterday. Bought Kelly a hamburger with only pickles and ketchup on it, and French fries and a strawberry shake. So on the way home, Kelly told me, Mom, this morning before I went to Heather's, I wrote out my Christmas list, but there's something that you can scratch off already. And I said, well, what's that, Kelly? And she said, it's a basketball. This morning, before Heather's mom came, we wanted to shoot some hoops in the driveway, and we went over to borrow Terrence's basketball next door, and he said, I have two, so you can just keep one of them. And once again, I was thinking, what a nice young man. You know, this good friend of Kelly's next door. So we went home, and I sat at the kitchen table with Kelly while she ate her hamburger. And we talked a little bit, and I announced to her that I had a dinner date that night with the man that I had been dating for a couple of years, and we were gonna go to dinner and go to a movie. And so when she finished her supper, she said, well, I'm gonna go out and shoot some hoops before it gets dark. And I told her, I'm gonna get in the shower. And as we both parted ways, the phone rang. So Kelly had already gone out the front door, and I answered the phone, and it was her girlfriend wanting to speak to her. Turns out she was wanting to see if they couldn't get together to spend the night again that night, because that girl's mom was going out on a date too. So I went to the front porch and I called Kelly in, and I remember thinking how cute it was, because Terrence was there. Kelly and Terrence were playing basketball in my driveway, and they both had on their athletic sweats from school, you know, the gray sweatshirt and sweatpants, and they were out shooting hoops in my driveway together. So I called Kelly in, she got on the phone, and you may have noticed one of the photos that you saw. She was sitting at the kitchen table with the phone up to her ear. I would not take $1 million for that photo, and I'll explain in just a minute. So I called her into the phone. I got in the shower. When I got out of the shower, it was starting to get dark. So I went to the front door in my bathrobe and called Kelly's name. She didn't come in. Well, something I didn't tell you about Kelly, another one of her attributes was she was incredibly punctual, and always I knew where she was. She would always tell me. She'd call me after school and say, Mom, if you call and I don't answer, it's because I'm gonna be out front practicing bars, or I'm gonna be in the back practicing beam, or I'm gonna go across the street to my friend's house. I always knew where she was. So when she didn't come in, I stepped out on the porch and called her name a little bit louder. Still no response. So what does a mom do? I went to the kitchen drawer, pulled out the student directory, and I called Terrence's house next door. Logical thing, right? So Terrence answers the phone, and I said, "Terrence, this is Ms. Brumbelow. Is Kelly there?" Which I didn't think she would be, because this was almost 30 years ago, and girls weren't allowed to go to boys' houses back then. You know, times were different. He said, "No, ma'am, I think she went to," and he told me some boy's name. And I thought, well, that's kind of odd, but I looked up that boy's name in the student directory and called there. The mom said, "No, he's not home. He's over at some other kid's house." I called there, finally talked to the boy, and he said, "No, I haven't seen Kelly since the movies last night." So I thanked him. I got into some clothes, started driving around the neighborhood. Any kid that was still outside, I'd roll down the window and say, "Have you seen Kelly?" "No, ma'am, I haven't seen her since yesterday at school or the movies last night." And I was telling everybody, if you see her, you tell her, come on straight home. So I was already starting to get a little bit concerned and a little bit worried. Went back home and, the first time I called Terrence was at 6:20 that Saturday evening. So I started getting ready for my date, and my date shows up promptly at 7 o'clock. He too was a very prompt, punctual person. He's standing at the front door holding the basketball. And I said, "Come on in, but we can't leave. Kelly's not here." And he said, "Oh, that's okay. I'll just flip on the TV and we'll wait until she comes." So I got back on the phone, called Terrence a second time. When he answered this time, he said, "Are you going to call the police?" And so I started trying to calm him down, telling him she probably told me where she was going, but I was in the shower. I didn't hear her. But if you think of where she is, or you see her, you tell her, come on home. And so I thanked him, hung up. I started going down the student directory. Every kid in there that I recognized their name, I was calling. I mean, I started calling neighbors. I was really getting nervous and upset. And my date knew already something is really wrong here, but he was trying to keep me concerned. And a couple of times I mentioned, I'm gonna have to call the police and report her missing. And he kept saying, "No, you're going to embarrass the kid to death. She probably called out and told you, you know, where she was. Just give her some time." And so finally, by 9 o'clock, he said, "Well, it's obvious we're not going to be able to go out and go to dinner, so let me go get some fast food. And is there any place that you want me to look while I'm out?" So I always ask the men in prison, and this up in Washington, nobody knew what this was, but most Texas guys do. I say, "Do you know what a Q-beam is?" My boyfriend drove a pickup truck, and he had a Q-beam in the big old console, one of those big old spotlights that plugged into the cigarette lighter. You know, this was 30 years ago. It wasn't electronic back then. And so I had told him there's a school playground, an elementary school, just a couple of blocks down. Sometimes the kids will hang out on that playground equipment and talk on the weekends. And I don't think she's there, but you might want to check there. So the next day, he told the police officer, he said, "When I was driving through the neighborhood, I was shining my Q-beam in all of the ditches because I already knew something bad had happened." And he said, "When I got to the school playground and I pulled up into the parking lot toward the playground equipment were the two big garbage dumpsters with the flip lids." And he said, "It took everything I could muster." And he's a big man, but he said, "It took everything I could muster to get out of my truck and go flip the lids of those dumpsters because I thought I was going to find Kelly in one." Well, he didn't, but as soon as he got to the point where he would not have been able to see my front porch in his rearview mirror, here goes this loud knock on my front door again. Guess who? Terrence. This time when I opened the front door, Terrence said, "Have you found her yet? Have you found her yet? I was fixing to go to bed, but when you find Kelly, tell her don't ever do anything like this again. I'm really worried about her." And I was thinking, what a nice young man. Now this time there was something odd though. He was standing on my front porch in these brightly colored, what some people call parachute pants. Back then some people called them MC Hammer pants. You know, again, bear with me, this was 30 years ago. He had on no shirt, no shoes, but these wildly colored pants. I'll never forget it as long as I live. So I thanked him, told him, if you talk to Kelly, you tell her come on home, because I'm really worried too. Closed the door. Eventually, my boyfriend came back with some fast food I couldn't eat. I mean, I was so sick at my stomach by then. So my boyfriend started walking the neighborhood with a flashlight. This was back in 1989 when the housing market had taken a major nosedive. And we had a lot of people in our small cul-de-sac that had their homes foreclosed on, and they had just packed up and moved in the middle of the night because they didn't want people to know that they were being forced out. And so he was going in and looking in the windows of these empty homes, thinking that maybe some vagrant had come through. Kelly was 4'11" tall. She was about to here on me, 89 pounds. I mean, she was a gymnast. She was very compact, tiny, cute little girl. And so he thought, you know, maybe some vagrant had her over there doing horrible things, and he didn't find her either. So I kept calling people until it got too late, and I told him, I've got to call the police. So I decided 11 o'clock, if she's not here, I'm going to call the police at 11, which I did. And they came out and took a missing persons report, which they're not supposed to do until 24 hours. But because she was 13 years old, they went ahead and did that. And so my boyfriend said, I'm not leaving until we find Kelly. So I paced the floor all night long. I mean, looking through the windows, you know, just when it started getting daylight the next morning, my boyfriend started walking the neighborhood, and I started calling people again. I was calling neighbors, will you take a picture of Kelly to church with you? We've got to spread the word. Kelly's been missing all night. So at one point, my boyfriend comes back into the house, and I said, I'm going to call Terrence's house once more. And he said, well, you better make it quick. He's fixing to leave for church. When my boyfriend was walking back up the sidewalk, Terrence was standing out in his driveway, in his dress slacks, his white shirt, his tie. He was leaning on the back of his mom and dad's car with his arms folded like this, just watching my boyfriend walking up and down the street, looking in people's yards. Walked right past him. Terrence didn't flinch, didn't say a word. So I called his house again. Terrence's mom answered the phone. I said, did Terrence tell you Kelly's been missing all night? Oh no, what happened? I don't know, but if you see her, if you know anybody that you can tell, you know, spread the word. We've got to get my daughter home. So she and Terrence went to church. I had at this point called the carpool girl across the street that Kelly was her best friend. And I was standing in my foyer. My boyfriend was still out walking the neighborhood, and I was standing in my foyer grilling this young girl. If you know anything, you won't get in trouble. Kelly won't get in trouble, but I've got to get her home. And she was telling me, no, ma'am, I haven't seen Kelly since the movies last night. So about that time, my phone rings, and somebody starts beating on the front door really loud again. And I told her, you grab the phone. I mean, she was just like another one of my kids. She practically lived at my house, you know, like teenage girls do. So she answered the phone. I opened the door. This time it wasn't Terrence standing on the porch. It was Terrence's dad. And he was standing there gripping his gut, and he kept stomping, saying, Judy, Judy, I found her, I found her. And he kept getting just louder and louder. And all I could think of was, good, I get to bring Kelly home. So I started running out behind him. We had a fence all the way around my front yard, and they didn't next door. So when we ran across my front yard, Terrence's dad yelled to me, I went out to get some firewood and I found Kelly. So I looked in their backyard where we were headed down my fence, and the people behind them had a fence too, so their yard was enclosed on three sides. I looked down and I saw a stack of firewood in the corner, and you know those great big wooden spools like electrical wire? A lot of people use them for picnic tables. Well, they had an empty one that they were using for a picnic table too. It was shoved up against the firewood, but out of that firewood, I saw two bare feet sticking up. They weren't my skin color. They were kind of a chalky, And I'm a reasonably intelligent woman, not the smartest one that ever walked the face of the earth, but I think I'm reasonably intelligent. I lost all logic at that point in time. I could not even think. My mind was saying, what is a mannequin doing in Joe Sampson's firewood? I ran up and then I just froze. I looked down and I could tell it was my daughter Kelly. Her sweat top that, you know, I told you she had on her athletic sweats, her sweat top was pulled up to about here. And moms and dads, you'll understand this, her bra was still fastened. And that meant the world to me later when I started processing things, because that told me possibly she wasn't molested. Her belly, all the way to her back, as far as I could see, was just scraped and bruised and was obvious it had been bleeding. But Kelly was real particular about her hair. I have really goofy hair. I mean, I had to work on it this morning to not be, you know, like this. I was worried about it being humid outside and coming in here looking like Bozo. Well, Kelly inherited my hair. And every morning before she'd, between athletics and first period, she was in the bathroom with the curling iron, you know, doing her bangs and stuff. So what stuck with me the most is that she was lying on her side, and in the top of her hair was this big brown gooey mass about this big that was just caked in dried grass and leaves. And I just stood there looking at her, just screaming at the top of my lungs. I couldn't move, I couldn't do anything. All I could do was scream. Well, my boyfriend was at least two blocks away and he heard me and he knew exactly what had happened. He comes barreling up. When he gets to where he could see me, I yelled, Kelly's hurt, she's hurt really bad, she needs an ambulance. And he ran up to me and he said, you go in the house and call the police and get a blanket. I'll stay here and take care of Kelly. So I went in. It was the school principal that had called my house that the neighbor girl was talking to. And so I yelled, call the police. I still to this day don't know if she was the one that called the police or if the principal did, but I grabbed a blanket, ran out. My boyfriend took it from me and he said, you wait out in the street to make sure the police know which house to come to. He didn't want me back there. So the police came. When they saw me, they said, do you know who this is? And I said, yes, it's my daughter, Kelly, that's been missing all night. She's hurt really bad. My mind was telling me, you know, this was God's defense mechanism. My mind was telling me she had been walking the top of the fence doing a balance beam, which I had seen her do many times before as a little girl. She had a balance beam in the backyard, but I mean, this was what was logically okay with me right now. And she fell and she busted her head. You know, that was how I kept my sanity at that point in time. So the police told us to go inside. It seemed like time stood still. Seemed like an eternity before an officer finally came in and he said, your daughter's dead, your daughter has been murdered, and we believe it's the boy next door. And I immediately said, no, 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 you've made a horrible mistake. Terrence is Kelly's friend, Terrence is a nice kid. Terrence is, I was doing all of the same things that I would have done if they had told me my child had done something like this. You know, I was the carpool mom. I knew this young man. The day before, sitting in my car, we had had a conversation about sports and about him being just as important as the senior quarterback. You know, I knew this boy. So I'm a very factual person. Maybe this comes from my IBM training, I don't know. But God has blessed me in so many ways. I asked the justice of the peace, who had to come pronounce Kelly dead, when you get the autopsy report, sir, would you please call me and tell me how my daughter died? So I was at work. He called. He asked me, are you sitting down? And I said, no, sir, but you just tell me what you've got. I can handle it. I'm a very fact-based person. I don't want people to sugarcoat things. You know, tell me what it is, and God and I will deal with it, right? So he told me that My daughter had been stabbed 97 times in the face and head with a serrated bread knife. What they finally found out is when Kelly and Terrence were playing basketball in the driveway, and I called Kelly in to answer the phone, Terrence decided that she was bullying him just like all the other kids at school, and he was going to go in and call my house. If she answered, yeah, that was, he was right. If the line was busy, everything was cool. He didn't take into account that we had call waiting on my phone. So she was talking to her girlfriend. He called. She heard the click. She told her friend, hang on a second. She clicked over and answered. Terrence said, come over, I want to show you a new video game I just got. She clicked back to her friend and said, I'll call you back in 5 minutes. Didn't say where she was going, what she was doing, just I'll call you back in 5 minutes. Walked over to his front porch. He opened the door and he said, it's on the table, step inside. He slammed the door and he told the intake officer, I stabbed her 6 or 7 times and she started telling me, Terrence, please stop. If you stop, I won't tell anybody. And with me being in church, I'm going to ask for forgiveness right here for what I'm about to say. He told the officer, that just pissed me off, and I decided to finish her off. So with her lying in the foyer incapacitated, he straddled her and just butchered her face. She was so badly damaged that they had to call some experts in from the Dallas-Fort Worth area to get her to the point where we could have a family visitation the night before the funeral, but we could not have an open casket funeral. And 12, 13, 14-year-old girls, or boys and girls, middle schoolers, they need to see reality. Those kids had such a hard time realizing that their friend was gone because all they were looking at was this closed casket there. It just, it broke my heart for those children. So my life drastically changed. My whole family's life drastically changed. My oldest daughter that I told you was always jealous of Kelly, when she turned 18, she had started realizing Kelly was really deserving of all of these medals and trophies and accolades because Kelly really did work for what she got. And Kelly worshiped the ground her big sister walked on. So my daughter, my oldest daughter, was trying to make up little bits and pieces, and it was going pretty slow, make up for all of the meanness, but she didn't get to finish her business, so she tried to commit suicide. Fortunately, I still have my oldest daughter. She turned 49 years old last Monday and is an absolutely beautiful human being now with wonderful kids. But she had a really, really hard time for many years. My youngest daughter, who had the learning disability, all of the emotional problems, that was the daddy's girl that went to live with dad, she was always big for her age, and Kelly was tiny. So by the time they were 2 and 4, my youngest daughter had already outgrown Kelly. So at 11 years old, when her sister was murdered, she told her dad, Daddy, if I hadn't moved here with you and I was still living with Mom and Kelly, because I'm bigger, I could have beat Terrence up and I could have saved my sister's life. Or because I'm not cute and smart and pretty and athletic, and I mean, she had a list a mile long, all these things, maybe Terrence would have killed me instead and nobody would have hurt as bad. So my 11-year-old daughter mentally checked out at 11 years old. Last week, she turned 41, and on a good day, she functions at maybe a 14, 15-year-old level. On a bad day, she's that 11-year-old all over again, right back there, you know, that her sister has been murdered, and it wasn't her. My ex-husband, Kelly's daddy, I think he may have suffered the most out of all of this because he moved away, and he's a construction guy, macho, big burly guy, never needed help from anybody for anything, wouldn't accept help from anybody from anything, even when times got really tough with us. You know, financially would not accept help. So he would not seek help for what was troubling him. He finally confided in one of his buddies who told his mother, my ex-mother-in-law, who told me, that every night he was having this recurring nightmare that Kelly was calling out, Daddy, Daddy, help me, and he couldn't get there to save his little girl. So he would wake up in the middle of the night, sitting up in bed, just dripping in sweat, with his heart pounding. And he lost weight like crazy. He was just, I mean, looking at him would just make you a nervous wreck. He was just like this. To this day, he cannot look at a picture of Kelly. I mean, it's just, it's too painful. So some of the things that have caused me the most struggle is I used to think that I would see Kelly places when I would be seeing other people's children. I wanted my daughter back so bad that I would see, like on the ice skating rink in Austin, one time I was there, and I saw this little girl out doing these swirls, and the way she would do her hands was just exactly like I had seen Kelly do hundreds of times in a gymnastics routine. Or one time I was driving home from work, and I wasn't thinking about Kelly, but I was in the right-hand lane of a four-lane, and we were stopped at a stoplight. And the car that was one car ahead of me in the other lane going my same direction, I saw a hand in the, I don't know why it was always hands, but I saw a hand up on the passenger window. My mind told me, Kelly's in that car. I started inching my way up. It's a wonder I didn't push the car in front of me through the intersection, because I wanted to get beside my daughter so bad. When the light changed and I got up there, it wasn't Kelly, it was a little boy that was sitting in the car. But I just ached for my child. So now let me tell you why I'm here today to talk to you about forgiveness. I dug my heels in because my heart and my head would not separate forgive and forget. And my heart said, Judy, you will never forget a single thing about your daughter Kelly. She was truly God's gift to me. And I have to back up and tell you, I've known a lot of people that have had a child die, and I've known a lot of them that turned against God and said, why did you, God, take my child from me? For some reason, the minute I found out my child was dead, I stopped and I said, thank you, God, for choosing me to be Kelly's mom. Out of all of the billions of women in the world, you chose me. And that was the most beautiful gift. And so I have always been incredibly grateful of the short time, and I now understand why Kelly was the special one, because I still have my other two daughters. You know? I got to pack an entire lifetime into 13 years, 1 month, and 5 days. And I am so incredibly grateful to God for that. But what I did that hurt me for a lot of years, and I'm sure it hurt a lot of people around me, I dug my heels in that no, I will not forgive Terrence Sampson. I will not forgive him, because if I do, I might forget Kelly, and I might worry that she was just a good dream. You know, sometimes my mind would play tricks on me, and I'd think, was she really real, or was this too good to be true? You know, am I just imagining this? And then I'd find something, you know, packed away that she had written. Or one time I was in the closet and I opened up the bin with all of her gym stuff and I pulled out her gym bag. I was sitting in the closet floor and I unzipped it and I got this whoosh of stinky gym smell. And I immediately zipped it up again and I said, thank you, God, she really was real. But what this did to me was I dug my heels in and I said, no way am I going to forgive Terrence Sampson. So every time his parole review would come up, you know, he got a 30-year sentence, was sentenced to Gidding State School until he turned 18. Then he went on to TDCJ and has been to several prisons in the system. But every time a parole review would come up, and I was right there getting people to write letters. I mean, I had letters from judges, doctors, attorneys, friends, family members, you name it. He had a file that was not a file. It was a box completely full of protests because I was determined he was going to stay in prison so that he couldn't hurt someone else. And I did this year after year, and I kept digging my heels in deeper and deeper. But in my Bridges to Life program, one of the chapters that we have is forgiveness. And I was going to this 14-week program, been doing it for 21 years now, and we would get to the week on forgiveness, and here I was teaching forgiveness and teaching these men and these incarcerated men and women that there are three aspects to forgiveness. There's forgiving people that have wronged you, there's being forgiven for the things that you've done wrong, and there's forgiving yourself. And I was teaching this, but I was a hypocrite. I was, because I wasn't practicing what I was preaching. Oh yeah, I could forgive myself for the things that I had done. I could ask for forgiveness from others when I had done wrong. But was I willing to forgive Terrence Sampson? No way. So back in 2016, one day, I did two Washington prison programs on Tuesdays there because it was too far for me to drive there twice a week. So I was at my afternoon program, and we were sitting in our small group, and we were on the forgiveness chapter. And one of the men looked me straight in the face, and he said, "Judy, this forgiveness we're talking about, when are you going to give it up?" And I went, you know, it was like, okay, God. And all this time, being a Christian, I knew that God expected me to forgive. I knew it. I learned this from the time I was a small child. And I kept carrying around, and the analogy I use, because my dad was a diesel truck driver, you know, a big rig truck driver all my life. And so my analogy was, if I get hit by a Mack truck on my drive home today, and I'm standing before my God asking to walk through those pearly gates to spend eternity in heaven with God and all my loved ones that have gone before me, and he asked me, first he says, "Judy, I've forgiven you," and he throws out this list all the way from here to Amarillo of things he's forgiven me for. And then he asked me the question, "And why haven't you forgiven Terrence Sampson?" The only answer I would have is, "I don't want to." And that's pretty lame, standing before God wanting to spend eternity in heaven, right? Pretty lame. So when this man asked me that, I said, "Okay, God, I know I need to do this, but I can't right now." So I went to dinner with my volunteers. I went to the project that evening. We were in our small group. One of the men leans forward. They're all looking at me because they know what's coming. We're on forgiveness week. One of them says, "Judy, you keep talking to us about all this forgiveness, but it's pretty obvious that you haven't forgiven Terrence. What's up with that?" And at that point, I looked that man in the eye, and I looked at every single one of them, and I said, "I am so sorry that I have spent the last 27 years carrying this burden around because it has been eating me alive inside." And I told each one of them, "Don't be stupid like me. Don't do what I did. Don't hold it inside. It's only hurting you." And so right then, I asked God to forgive me for being so stubborn and not being willing to do what I knew was right all along. And he lifted that burden. And you cannot imagine what it feels like to have been filled with this anger and and resentment and bitterness, and all of a sudden, it's just not there anymore. And I started praying for Terrence. And all along, I'd been praying that he would never hurt anyone again. But then my prayer changed to, you know, I hope that he can, once he is released from prison, that he can get out and be successful and have a good life. And it just, yeah, I mean, it's just such a relief. And so if you are carrying around some unforgiveness, don't be stupid like Judy. Don't hang on to it, because it's not worth it. It's really not worth it. You know, accept God's blessing and let it go. And I think that's all I have. Thank you, Junior.